Good morning. I'm Deb Sullivan, trainer from the Office of Academic Affairs, Faculty Development. I want to welcome you to this morning's prime time. This is jointly hosted by Faculty Development, Friends of the Bethel Library, and the Bethel Library. And I have a brief advertisement from them, advertising the competition for student research papers. Please encourage your students to consider applying. There's a $250 prize, and the deadline is February 15th. There are a few things you cannot be graduating before May 12th, so December graduates, it won't work. The work can be in any medium. It can be a paper, it can be a video. The work must be completed in spring or fall, or interim of fall 11 or interim 12. And it doesn't require any additional research. And they want to make things really easy for you. These little pieces of paper, there are some in this little envelope down there, and there are some over there by the refreshments. So you can just grab one of these and you can staple it onto a paper that you think is really great, and then get it to the library, and they will be glad to put it in the competition. Our next prime time will be Dr. Joy Doan. She's one of the, she'll be presenting research with Luke Lindeen and Kent Nichols on regulation of macrophage activation, floating the RAS hypothesis, which I'm sure is really meaningful. But one of the things I really like about these prime times is that you learn about the different work that people are doing, the different research, and I know that by the time she's been presenting, I'll actually understand it, so I invite you to attend that. Today we have the great honor of recognizing Dr. Samuel Zalonga. We award three awards each year from the faculty to choose someone for excellence in scholarship, excellence in teaching, and excellence in service. And Dr. Samuel Zalonga was selected for excellence in scholarship. Samuel has served as the associate editor for the Journal of Third World Studies, the Africa section. He was selected by Sage Publications to collaborate on the instructor and student site for religion and sociological perspective. And on the basis of his work, they've asked him if he would also be one of the area experts in the field of sociology, development, and pedagogy. He's been a prolific contributor to edited volumes in his field and a prolific contributor to our faculty discussions, whether it's in this setting or online on the CAS faculty discuss. And I know working with him on the Guatemala term, what a deep heart he has for helping our students learn and to grow and to take them where they are and to bring them to a different place for the time to assemble. So I'm honored to introduce you, Dr. Samuel Zalonga.
Well, thank you very much for taking the time to come. I really appreciate that very much. Before I start the presentation, I would just like to say a little bit about myself. As you notice, I speak with accent. I come from Nigeria. I grew up in the northern part of the country, northeastern part of the country, in a peasant family. My parents are ordinary peasant farmers. There are no peasant farmers in the United States. But what that simply means is, if you are in a developing country, they are the poorest of the poorest farmers who just use simple technology to cultivate things for survival. My parents worked with an American missionary who was from the United States, from Toledo, Ohio. They became Christians and they went to Bible school. So my mother she's a Sunday school teacher still. So I was raised in a Christian family. We had to read the Bible really very seriously. So when I came to the United States, being a Christian is not necessarily strange to me, but as you will see from my presentation, there are certain issues that I really had to deal with. My growth as a scholar was all in Bethel because I graduated at the University of Minnesota in 2000 and then started teaching in Bethel. So any reflection I make here is based on the courses that I've taught. I've taught different courses in Bethel, and when I teach these courses, I do not only focus, I reflect on the material, but I'm interested in seeing how do materials from different courses help me shed light or understand something on a particular issue. And over time, I started becoming very, very concerned about this topic of the question of human dignity. So the reason why I chose this topic is just like this, a reflection of something I've been struggling with, not only as a Christian, but also as a scholar and as somebody who is really concerned about the future of humanity. Of course, we all have very short time period to live in this world, but I grew up poor, and when I came to the United States initially, I thought it was going to be great. this is paradise on earth. A few years after I came to this country, I realized that just from my own reflection that there must be something deeper in life than just being in the United States. So the problem of life is, initially you think like there's some kind of New Jerusalem there, then when you go there after some time, you realize there must be something much deeper. So yeah, and now, based on my reflection, I just feel that even if you endorse the whole Bethel institution to me and gave it to me as a gift, it's not going to satisfy me because I know that there are a lot of people really suffering. So, and I know that deep in me, naturally, there's nothing that tells me that if you have this, it is enough. You can give me the whole of Bethel today, and tomorrow I'll tell you that there's still a college across the street, which is Northwestern. I also want it. So what is it in human being that really say, this is enough, or you can live with this and have some kind of meaningful experience in life? To me, this is really the struggle. I can buy a new car, I can get all those kind of things, but I started thinking very deeply. There must be something really deep, really out there. So this whole question of on the fragile dignity of humanity was something that started becoming a concern to me when I taught social inequality. And normally when I teach social inequality, I start from ancient Greek civilization, and we walk through the different periods in Western civilization. Those of you who are familiar with CWC or Western humanities know that this is the kind of sequence. So what I found out was that there's this virus of inequality, or some human beings trying to oppress other people or take control over them. And this virus mutates itself over time. In other words, inequality or injustice does not remain the same. It changes over time. It's like a virus, but it continues to do that. And if you're very careful, you can trace how this virus appeared at a certain point here, and then by this period, it changed something else, and then another point, it changed something else. And with regard to the whole question of Christianity in this respect, which I'm going to really talk about, and I'm very concerned about that because I teach a course social justice and Christian responsibility, I am very convinced that people's beliefs can really inspire them to make a difference or to transform the world. But at this moment, if you tell me that Christianity is going to be able to transform the world, I'll say, okay, I agree with you, but as a sociologist, I would ask you, tell me, why is it that after 2,000 years, the 11th hour on Sunday is still the most segregated hour in America? Are you telling me that the Holy Spirit has not been working in the past until now? Or that the power of the Holy Spirit was released just to a certain degree in the past, but from now onwards, it will be released in all its power? Or what is it that did not happen in the past 2,000 years of Christianity that is going to happen in the future that would convince me that things are going to change? Now, most Christians don't want to ask this question because it's almost like holding a mirror to yourself. Because if we cannot explain why, with all the best writings in Christian theology and everything in the past 2,000 years of Christianity, we have not been able to transform the world the way it was expected, you cannot guarantee me just like that and then expect me to go home and sleep and yeah, we will just transform the world. No. We have to really look at the facts. What is really going to change in the world is going to be transformed. So this is why I decided to focus on this presentation. And just in summary, one of the things I want to emphasize throughout this presentation is that throughout human history, the question of human dignity is something very fragile. Something really, really very contingent. And I would argue that even the whole concept of the idea of the human is very problematic because it changes over time. It's kind of really, really contingent, and I'm not sure that anyone can guarantee anybody that this is exactly what is human. Now, saying that doesn't mean that I don't care about what it means to be human. I think this is really, really very important. But sometimes we just take it for granted, and as Christians, we use the idea of human dignity created in the image of God and all those kind of things. But people will say that in the church and they go out and immediately do something totally different, contradicting what they just said. Okay, if I truly believe that you have the same dignity as I do, it will be very difficult for me to deny you something when I think I deserve it and go home and sleep neatly without feeling concerned. If I truly believe that you have the same dignity, in order for me to really deny you something, I have to come up with an explanation that convinces me and convinces you to rationalize the fact that, well, we are all human, but he or she does not deserve this because of this and that. And if you look at human history, we have done quite a lot of that, whether in religion or other areas. If somebody wants to deny something from you, the first thing they try to do is they come up with some kind of rationalization to take away some part of your humanity. If they are able to do that, then they can exonerate their conscience, go home and sleep, even though they treated you just like an animal. Because they've been able to convince themselves that you don't deserve what they deserve, because even though you're a human, but because of this. So with this introduction, I'll try to leave 10 minutes at the end so that we can have some discussion. But first, the meaning of the term human, as I've said, and humanity is tentative, and it changes over time. And then the next thing I want to talk about is just, why is this topic really very relevant? Well, the first thing is the contrast between biblical ideal of human dignity and the concrete reality in history. All of us Christians will always talk about we are created in the image of God, our dignity is in God, or whatever. Okay, I agree with that. But then look at human history in the Old Testament. If you look at human history in the Old Testament, it's not clear that you can say whether this human dignity is just for everyone or is just for certain people that were chosen. Philip Jenkins wrote an article in the Boston Globe about just some verses that just clearly demonstrate terror in the Old Testament, where, if you like, in today's language, genocide was committed in the Old Testament. Okay? So, and then, even though we do say that God liberated the people of Israel out of Egypt, which is true, but when I check Egyptian history, I found out that at the very time that liberation took place, it didn't mean that everybody in Egypt was free. There were a lot of other Egyptians that were also under oppression. Okay? Not every Egyptian was a hero or something like that. But the scripture did not say anything about their own liberation. So, but the way we talk about human dignity is that this human dignity is available to everyone, irrespective of who you are, irrespective of your race, your ethnicity, or whatever. So why were the Egyptians not considered? Okay? This is a very fundamental problem for me. Some of us here would not like to ask this question, but I have to ask this question. You can't just talk about the liberation of Israelites and ignore the fact that there were many Egyptians who were used to build the Pharaoh's pyramids and all those kind of things, okay? So the other thing is, when the Israelites moved to the Promised Land, literally a lot of genocide were committed. And if you read the scripture really very well, it's not clear that those people were even given the opportunity to kind of give their lives to God or whatever. It was just a question of they were in the wrong place at the wrong time they were at the wrong place at the wrong time and they were not part of the chosen people. I struggle with this really very, very much. I cannot read the Old Testament and just ignore this reality. So enough about that. The other thing is the multiplicity of creation stories. If you really look very carefully, you find out that in the eastern part of the world, there were other creation stories that sometimes we do not know about. But those creation stories are very similar to the creation story in the Bible. And when you look at it really very carefully, every creation story has some kind of idea of where God is. There's a hierarchy, everybody has his or her place. There's some kind of essential description of who the people in that hierarchy really are. And sometimes their roles actually in history is shaped by the way they are defined in that creation story. So what you find out here is that in almost all of these creation stories, people try to put themselves in the center of the story. So you go to China, you find out that you have the idea of the Middle Kingdom. So Chinese people never thought of themselves equally as inferior to anybody, okay? If you go to Latin America, in the Inca or whatever, groups have their creation story, and they play a very important role in that creation story. So the problem you have is that, literally sometimes what is happening is that, if I have my creation story, I can literally go to you and just say that, well, my God told me that you should stand up from this couch and leave it to me because I am entitled to it. You have to leave. But you may have your own creation story too. And your own creation story may say that, you know what, my creation story, my God told me that you should go and stay out there in the cold because this is what God told me, that this is what you really deserve. So how do you decide whose creation story is really true? Because sometimes these creation stories are used to dehumanize others. If you tell me your own creation story and you want me to be part of your creation story, if that affirms my humanity, I think I can understand that. But if becoming part of your creation story means I have to accept a dehumanized status, I think there's some problem there. Mm. And when you look at it really very carefully, is that in almost every religion, people use creation stories to kind of create a hierarchy of second-class citizens. Mm. So what do we do with that? Mm. We all have Christian stories, but my fear is that when people use Christian stories to dehumanize other groups of people, you can go into other religions to talk about that. I don't have the time to do that here. And I've already talked about the God of the Old Testament, the difference between some that have been chosen and some that have not been chosen. If you look at the Indian caste system, you find out that it's the same thing. You have the Brahmin, then you have all these other kids, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, then you have the untouchables. Yeah, so people, that kind of hierarchy of existence doesn't recognize the humanity of other people as others. So again, you find another problem there that, okay, what your dignity is as a human being is very, very contingent historically, depending on where things, depending on where you are located. And then when you look at the ancient Greeks, because I know in the Western tradition, we trace this civilization back to the ancient Greeks. But if you look at Hesiod, Theogony, which is the history of creation, you find out that presumably there was everything perfect in the cosmos, but then somebody did something that offended Zeus, and Zeus was very angry. Then he decided to punish man, and I'm using man in the specific meaning of that word, man. So he punished man by giving him a woman. And that woman's name is Pandora. And Pandora was given a box that contained all the affliction of this world. And Pandora was so reckless that she opened the box and all the afflictions escaped into the world. And then you have all these problems. Now, if you start in your creation story with this assumption about women, definitely you don't treat them as really equal, okay? So again, even if you look at the ancient Greeks, it's not like their myth necessarily really puts women at equal level with men. And then you look at slavery. The Athenians had freedom in their own city for certain groups of people, but others are slaves. And then they went and colonized other people. If you look at the speeches of Pericles, one of the debates they had about the colonization of other ancient Greek societies, say, well, you know, colonialism is bad, definitely based on our idea of freedom, but if you relinquish it, you're going to lose many privileges. Okay? So even though we talk about the freedom and democracy in ancient Greece, understand that it was built on the back of some people. Women did not have the kind of freedom that we expected, we assume that women should have in a society that is equal. And then you look at the work of other philosophers, like what Socrates said or what Pericles said about women or what Aristotle said about women. Aristotle, in particular, made a distinction between people who use their bodies and people who use their mind, and he thought women use their body, they cannot use their mind, and that is why they are inferior. Okay? So again, what I'm trying to say here is that if this concept of human dignity is supposed to be universal and apply to everybody, in this case, even in the works of some of the ancient Greek philosophers, you find out that the status of some human beings is historically contingent. There is no guarantee that they are really fully human. Okay? Okay. Then from there you move to the Roman Empire. Ooh. I agree that one of the things that I am really impressed about with the Roman Empire is this idea that people could come from the faraway territories that were conquered and still be citizens of the empire, and some of them even rose to the position of becoming emperors or something like that. So that's great. But make no mistake about that. Women did not have the same kind of rights. They were not treated as full human beings as men in the Roman Empire. And even among women, your status, your dignity as a human being depended on your social class and whether you live in the city or rural area. Okay? So you have all these nuances. Again, when you look at that very carefully, there's nothing to impress you that human dignity is just something that is just there, you can take for granted, it applies to everyone. And then next, Luther's Reformation. If you look at Luther, he had some mixed feelings about the Jewish people, and he said some terrible things about them, okay, which took away some aspect of their humanity. This is a very, some people make this point, and it's very controversial, but some people really say that some of the things that he said there created some kind of long tradition of almost anti-Semitism because of the negative things he said about them. He wanted them to give their lives to Christ. They were not willing to do that, so he went after them, if you like. Some scholars say that he was not anti-Semitic, but he was anti-Judaism. In other words, he's just angry about them because they were not believers of Judaism, not because they were Jewish people. So that's a distinction that some people really make. Luther was not sympathetic to the peasants in Germany who were... So again, if you're talking about human dignity, you think like the way the Bible talks about it, yeah, we say it every time in church, everybody's created equal in the image of God. Yeah, that's an ideal, but Luther didn't necessarily sympathize with the German peasants, and he allowed them to be killed. And then Luther did not object to slavery. And I thought this was quite interesting, because if Luther had made a big deal about slavery, probably the Puritans, when they came here, they would not have necessarily... Anyway, later on, it shouldn't have been a problem, because these Puritans were really people who came out of the Reformation. So if this was a co-issue, then probably slavery should not have come up in the United States. Okay, again, what this shows you is that the dignity of human beings is historically contingent, okay? And then you have Columbus, okay? Briefly, let's just say Columbus' encounter with the Native Americans. The main point I want to make here is that the distinction between people who came from Europe and the Native people here was whether the people here had souls or not. Whether you had soul or not was very, very important on what happened to you, okay? So in this case, because the native people of this country were considered not to have souls, they were considered to be a fair game. Okay, this happened also in South America. Again, these are Christian people who came here, but the way they interpreted the Bible led them to treat other people in a manner that you cannot say that simply because we believe that human beings have dignity rooted in the fact that they are created in the image of God. This guarantees everything. There's a lot of historical contingency there. And then the Enlightenment. If you look at the Enlightenment also, you feel like, well, this is the time when we become really civilized and everybody should respect each other. But the Enlightenment itself has its own internal problems with regard to the treatment of other people. First, the Enlightenment emphasized rationality really very much, and women were considered to be very emotional in some cases. So this kind of made them to be treated as relatively inferior. And then you look at the work of people like Immanuel Kant, who said, sapere aure, dare to think, in other words, that ability to think on your own is the distinctive thing about the Enlightenment. And Immanuel Kant had this idea that this ability to think is rooted in your mindset. It's kind of like rooted in your brain or whatever. So if I can think this way and you cannot think that way, then I can say that, well, you are less than human because I have the capacity to think, to be able to produce this thing, but you are unable to do that. And this is why some people argue that there is some racial implications in Immanuel Kant's idea of the Enlightenment. And then what surprised me about the Enlightenment also is like Rousseau, J.J. Rousseau, for instance, here's somebody that otherwise you would say is very, very committed to social justice. His article, for instance, on discourse on inequality or whatever. But if you read what he wrote about women, is it in the A-mile, yeah, you find out that this same guy who is against injustice in general, but when it comes to gender, he didn't think of women really to be equal to men, okay? So even within the Enlightenment, you get this kind of like contradiction. And then you check Diderot's encyclopedia of Voltaire's philosophical dictionary, just go there and check the entry on women. When you read it, you feel like these are people coming from another planet, the way they describe them, okay? So again, what I'm saying here, even in the Enlightenment, the dignity of human beings is not just guaranteed. There is some kind of contingency to that. So my hope is that this just gives you an idea that we should not just be going to church and just say, we are creating the image of God or whatever, and just be satisfied with that. We have to look at history. We have to ask ourselves, how does this translate into reality? Because otherwise, we can go to church and say all these things and then get out there and just do something totally different. Finally, in this section, I would like to talk about the Jim Crow and the civil rights struggle. Again, this is something that is probably about 50, 60 years ago, but what I thought was quite interesting, especially after participating in the Sankofa trip, is how amazingly people, even in the 1950s, were willing to deny other people the same kind of rights, just basic rights, that they take to be very important for themselves. Again, it goes back to the point I made much earlier. How can I say that I'm entitled to this because I'm a human being and then deny you those same things? Now, to me, the most inspiring thing about the civil rights thing was, civil rights struggle was when we went on the Sankofa trip, was to realize there were many white people who took the risk to identify with the struggle because they realized that there's some moral question there. Mm-hmm. I have a documentary in the office where this woman, she's just a housewife, you might call it, during those days, but she stood up in a meeting and just took a position that, you know, the children of these black people are not given a fair treatment as our own children. She wanted the school to be kind of integrated. Now, going back, reflecting on what she did, I thought it was really courageous for a woman, just a housewife, to stand up in a town meeting to really say that. So there were some courageous people, but again, it goes back to the point I'm just trying to say. Don't just say that human beings are created in the image of God and be satisfied with that. You have to look at history really very well. The other thing that I think is even making this more dangerous is when you compare the Catholic tradition and say the Protestant tradition as represented by the work of Reinhold Niebuhr. Reinhold Niebuhr came out with this concept of Christian realism, the question of sin. Now, you know, don't just talk about this kind of ideas without understanding the problem of sin. And within the evangelical community, people sometimes use original sin to excuse so many things. I can literally trick you back and just say, oh, you know, is this original sin? So instead of original sin, so it's a question of interpretation. I'm not saying that that should be the case, but people just refuse to do certain things that should be done based on our values, based on our commitment. They'll just say, it is because of original sin, original sin, original sin. Okay, enough about that. Let me rush quickly to the next section where I would like to talk about the present time. The human being after the welfare state, insights from Friedrich von Hayek. Now, for those of us here who may not be familiar with the concept of the welfare state, what I just simply mean by that is this kind of state that came into existence after the Second World War in Western Europe and the United States or North America, where we made a commitment to set a minimum standard for human beings in terms of how they live their lives. So this was when we started saying, if you are a citizen, you are a human being, we believe that you are entitled to certain basic necessities that have to be guaranteed to you by this society. It's not because you're educated, you have a college degree. It's not because of whatever thing, but at least some minimum standard. So that was where the idea of welfare state and other things came into existence. And I mentioned the four freedoms that Franklin Delano Roosevelt talked about, which I think were really very, very important, that the idea he wanted an America, and not only America, but the whole world, to be based on those freedoms. One of them is freedom from want, one of them is, anyway, their freedoms are there. I'm not going to waste so much time talking about that. And then in the 1960s onwards, we had the war on poverty when President Johnson was in office. Again, there were so many programs that were implemented at that time. Now, there are some problems with the implementation of those programs. I don't deny the programs were, there were some problems. But again, my feeling is that this was a time in American history where people thought it was very, very important for us to care for each other, and we have to set the minimum. So we cannot just say that we are a society and just ignore the possibility of some people falling in the abyss. By the abyss, I mean, if the state is not willing to support some people, then if they fall, they fall. There's no limit to where they can go down. Okay, enough about that. Now, I want to talk about the ideas of Friedrich von Hayek, whose ideas have become very, very influential in American society, or I would say in the whole world. I would argue that many evangelicals support the ideas, not all, many evangelicals support the ideas of Friedrich von Hayek, but indirectly. They may not be aware of that, but because you have to understand how evangelicals, many evangelicals vote, who they vote for, and then you look at those people they vote for in office, whose ideas do they espouse, where are the sources of those ideas. That's how you can make this kind of connection. So let me briefly go over some of his ideas. Friedrich von Hayek is opposed to any collective effort in the pursuit of social justice. Friedrich von Hayek does not believe that there's even a concept of social justice. He said most people who talk about social justice don't just know what they're really talking about. Okay? Now, I can get into this because there's quite a lot of discussion we can have about that, but let me say this. Friedrich von Hayek comes to this discussion with a very under-socialized conception of the human being. The concept of social justice is espoused significantly by Catholic social teaching. And Catholic social teaching is reacting to a conception of the human being that is so individualistic, almost atomistic, totally out of the idea of community. So when Catholics use the word social justice, they are trying to make a statement there. This idea that you can think of a human being just existing out there, just out there in space, not being part of the community, is a fiction. It doesn't exist. There's not any human being that really exists in that respect. What really makes me human is being part of the community. So the idea of social for them is really trying to make this point. And the idea of the common good is related to that also. But Friedrich von Hayek comes to this discussion with a very, very atomistic conception of the individual. So this is one of the differences. And he doesn't believe in collective effort. Why doesn't he believe in collective effort? Because he believes that there's no government that has monopoly over insight on how things should be done. So he wants this whole idea about how things should be done to be decentralized in different communities because they know their problems really better or something like that. But the implication of that is that if you really apply this argument for Christians who support von Hayek, what that simply means is that the church has no business in telling you to be moral. Because what the church is doing there is that it is the church is assuming that these pastors have a monopoly what morality is. No. Decentralized morality in that case, if you apply the logic of his argument. I should know the morality of my family. Everybody should know the morality of family. The church has no business in telling people how they should live their life. If the church is able to do that, you can apply the same logic to say that, well, why not have some specific role for the state to intervene? Because the state may know something better than individuals, okay? This is an issue that is seriously really debated, but what I'm saying here is not kind of imposing any kind of interpretation on Friedrich von Hayek. Friedrich von Hayek has no plan for the church in his plan for society, and people should be aware of this. He just feels the church is not relevant. If the church wants to be relevant, it starts to struggle in the marketplace just like any other business firm. He treats churches as business firms. If they want to survive, they have to produce a product, taking into consideration consumer tests. If they ignore consumer tests, they are going to be out of business. And this is why many churches today, in many churches, pastors are not able to preach the truth. Why? Because their churches are based on mortgages. If you decide to really preach very seriously, people are going to leave. If the people leave and you don't have tax base, or in the city we talk about tax base, but in this case we're talking about the money that they collect from people. If all the rich people in your church leave, how are you going to pay the mortgage? And right now there are many churches that have lost their building because they can't pay the mortgage. They are in economic crisis. So what you do is, you study your congregation really very well. Don't go so far. Just say something that is what some people call middle-class values. Just preach middle-class values, okay? And latch the name of Jesus somewhere. If you can do that, then you do very fine. You do very fine. They come to church, they go out feeling like affirmed. They don't feel there's a need for them to improve themselves because there's a need for them to go in prayer on their knees before Jesus and realize, Lord, I realize that I'm limited in this way. No. They are affirmed. They are the citizens of the most powerful country in the world, according to one scholar. They leave the church feeling that. So you don't feel really challenged when you go to church. You feel really very comfortable because you feel affirmed. So anyway, enough about that. He treats the function of the free market as sacrosanct. In other words, Friedrich von Hayek is very, very concerned about maintaining the market. The role of the market is very, very important for him. The market generates information, the market sends signals, and all those kind of things. Nobody is able to do that. So he's more concerned about safeguarding the status of the market than the status of the church. And then three, there's nothing as economic values. What he's saying here is just that it's nonsense for people to talk about something being economic. But because he argues that people use the market to pursue things that are evil, and people use the market to pursue things that are good. So the market is just a neutral mechanism. So I can go to the market and work because I want to raise my children, because I want to donate money and give it to a missionary in Africa or Latin America, just in the market. So he would argue that it's not the market that is the problem. The market is just a mechanism for me to achieve that goal. So he says, therefore, the market, talking about economic values, is nonsense. Everything is connected to everything. Okay, I was told that I have very limited time left. One other thing that I would just want to say about Friedrich von Hayek, let me talk about the ethical implications and then just one or two things. One, demand and supply means the revaluation of human beings based on their economic value. If you look at the ethical implication of Friedrich von Hayek's way of thinking, one of the things he's saying is that your value is not based on your human dignity. And that's what I mean by the disappearance of the human. Your value depends on your standing in the market. Do you have, what is your human capital? What contribution do you make economically? If you don't make any contribution economically, it's like you don't exist. Good examples of that, Joseph Stiglitz argues that it is better to be a cow in Europe than to be a kind of human being in Africa. Let me repeat it again. It is better to be a cow in Europe than to be a kind of human being in Africa. What he was saying here is that in a globalized economy, where your significance is not about your human dignity, as we talk about in the Bible, it's about your contribution. Do you have something to buy? Are you having some standing in the market or not? So in Europe, the EU subsidized every cow $2 per day. In Africa, there are a lot of human beings who do not make $2 per day. So in terms of economic standing, the cow is more relevant because it generates money. But those human beings in Africa are not relevant. They don't exist in that respect. When the crisis in Haiti happened, more than 200 people really died. It didn't affect the shares of the market in New York. I've been following the story. I keep track of those stories. So economic geographers use the term surplus population. Surplus population are people who you can bury 100,000 people today if they don't have any, if they don't represent any important consumption in the global economy. It's not going to affect the shares of the market in Wall Street. Okay? But you can kill 10 people unpredictably on Wall Street and that can bring down shares. So, in this respect, there's no question of like, you have some guaranteed human dignity in this kind of market. Okay, enough about that. Let me conclude by just talking about what is the role of the church in this unraveling historical drama. I feel very terrible about this. I feel really, really very concerned about this. Let me just take point number four and conclude with that. Point number four just talks about the church as bureaucratic and social organization and the possibility of desirable change. And then I'll talk about the National Association of Evangelicals. What I mean here is that during the civil rights struggle, there was this idea that somebody was very concerned. Why is it that these ministers are not standing and preaching the truth about the fact that this is not right, what was happening was not right? So he went and met the younger people in their congregation, the pastors, and said, why are you not saying this? Well, they said, you know, I'm just waiting until a time when I reach very high position, when they can do nothing to me, then I can speak out and I will be okay. But right now, because I'm really very young in the organization, I'm just a young pastor, I'm very insecure. So the guy said, okay, I understand what you're saying. Let me go and meet those people who are high in the organization, who are secure. Probably they will be able to say something. So he went and met them and interviewed them. And what did they say? They say, you know, I've invested so much in this organization that at this point, I'm not willing to risk just losing all that I have invested, I've achieved up to this time. So the church as an organization, as a bureaucratic organization, faces this challenge, spiritual versus market. And on the one hand, the church can tell the truth and whatever, but it can easily be disciplined by the market if it decides to do that. Because people are really concerned about their status in society and all those kind of things. The National Association of Evangelicals is unable to speak in the United States, is unable to speak on many, many important problems that we have in this country with a moral, which I think the church should be able to take a stand, simply because there's not some kind of deep agreement within the association. The only thing that they can agree on is a certain kind of minimum. And that minimum that they can talk about in agreement, all of them agree about, is so ordinary that it's almost like something that you might not have reason to oppose them. But the moment you begin to increase the lowest common denominator to a higher level, then there's going to be disagreement. So in this respect, even though we have the National Association of Evangelicals, because of the division within among evangelicals, they are unable to take a stand on many issues publicly because they are afraid of that. So in that respect, don't expect very much from evangelicals taking strong on so many as a group, as an association. Different churches can do that. There are churches who are doing a very good job in that respect. So I conclude in this respect with the saying that I still have hope. My hope is that a generation would be risen in every historical period that is going to make life uncomfortable to those people who are at the top. Well, that's my conclusion. Thank you. Any questions or any comments, please?
Dr. Zalangi, you just talked about a generation being risen to make those uncomfortable at the top. In light of those remarks, I'm wondering if you can offer your reflection on the Occupy Wall Street.
The Occupy Wall Street, in my view, I attended a conference recently at Grand Valley State University in Michigan, and one of the points that was made there, which I believe is really true, is that some people think the only way these people can be successful or would have been successful is to either overthrow the government or some kind of bring some kind of change. But I've been in this country for 18 years. All of you, or most of you, were born here. How many times in your lifetime was there a serious discussion on social inequality in America like that, like it was on the table? So if nothing, in my view, they have brought this issue on the table that I watch CNN that nobody would talk about it. By the way, I do not believe that we will have a society where everybody is equal. But by the same token, I don't believe that. You could just say that the market should be the main, that social justice or justice in our society should just be based on commutative exchange, which means whatever you get through the market is just what you're entitled to. There's nothing beyond that, okay? So in my view, it's really a great achievement because I never thought this is going to happen in the United States, because Habermas talks about the fact that sometimes what makes it very difficult for us to really understand each other is distortion in communication. Distortion. And we have a lot of distortion in communication in the United States today. Much of the lack of understanding has to do with distortion, some kind of dominant ideologies that make it very difficult for us to relate to each other. I review a lot of documentaries, and I can tell you that sometimes after watching the documentary, I'll say, this person in Africa needs to talk to this person in Idaho. Yeah. Because even though they are far away, but when you look at what they're really going through, they need to share some coffee and just talk about their problems. Nobody is going to bring them together. Black people, white people, Latino, when you look at their problems, yes, they have a lot of unique differences or whatever, but when you look at their situation, they would benefit more by coming together. But society is not interested in bringing them together, because if they bring them together, somebody is afraid that these people are going to develop a sense of consciousness that is over and above the divide and rule. So that's my response to that.
I'm wondering if we could take Amir's comment and apply it more towards that one. So for those of us on the faculty, we might have an idea of what Christianity is and what this one is. Pretty soon you end up with, say, a student like Ryan in your class who's pushing you. And others, okay? And yet the institution constrains access to space and voice of the next generation saying, we didn't get it quite right, this idea of Christianity and human dignity. And so the institution may actually squash the very thing that we're attempting to bring to fruition.
Yeah, this is really a very important question. I'll just answer it sociologically. I know this is better, so I want to be very careful about what I say. Okay.
Yeah, I'm interested in your sociological.
Yeah, yeah. But my sociological analysis is, and actually this came out of the conference I attended with some Bethel faculty in Calvin College last year about issues in Christian higher education. One of the things that I didn't make a presentation there, but I listened very carefully. One of my observations was that Bethel is a Christian institution, and this is part of the crisis that if I had the time to go over all I have written, we would have talked about. We are a Christian organization, but we live in a capitalist society, okay? You and I are Christians, but we have to make decisions based on the fact that we live in a capitalist society. There are many people who would not like to live with minorities simply because they invest a lot of their money in their housing, and the trend in America indicates that when minorities move to or whatever, the impression people have is that the value of the property is really going to go down or whatever. So you find people who are otherwise very normal people who don't have any racial or whatever, but because of economic incentive, they behave in a certain way which would be contrary to their Christian beliefs. So in the same way, what would happen, what is really happening to Bethel, and I would argue that there is no Christian organization that can ignore the market. Part of the reason why we fear In my view, the reality we're dealing with in the United States today is people tend to fear the market more than they fear God. Because the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is very patient. Many people insult him, offend him, but he's very, very patient. It doesn't mean that he doesn't punish people, but he's very patient. But try the market. It teaches you a lesson immediately. If Bethel would make some kind of miscalculation or whatever, they will suffer the consequences. So what it boils down to with all these Christian organizations, including churches, is that they have to take into consideration the reality of the fact that they live in capitalist society. And my argument is, Christians better take this really very seriously, because they assume they can have the most dynamic capitalist economy or whatever, and they still have their Christian beliefs really okay, intact. But the reality is that even I, as a person, sometimes I make decisions that I'll say, this is a Christian ideal, this is what I should do. But based on market rationality, this is what I should do. So I think in many respects, Bethel has to be concerned about stakeholders outside the institution. What happens in this institution is not just a question of those of us inside the campus, but there are also interests that are outside the campus, which can make life difficult for the administrators, I suppose.
Yeah. Well, I think going off of that too, if as a market society we have, you know, taken in these market capitalist values and penetrated into other spheres of our life, I think one of my biggest concerns is that the church, which is called to one of its most important roles to be a prophetic voice in society when it goes, you know, against God's will, how is it, especially amongst evangelicals who tend to really hold on to this idea that I look at the Bible and I know truth because I can read the Bible myself, and not have a sense of collective, you know, at least unified doctrine within a church that says this is how we're going to at least say we're going to approach the Bible. Instead, there's usually this idea that when I read it, I can pull out God's truth from it on my own. And so I think you see this division amongst especially the evangelical church, and they don't recognize the way that the market society has penetrated into their values and the ways that they approach this Bible. And so we just see separation and complete dissonance amongst its constituents. And so if that's the case, I worry about evangelicals' ability to recognize the way that their historical position has co-opted their values and the way they approach the Bible. And if that's the case, I doubt their ability to actually play that prophetic and largely important role for rebuilding of the kingdom. So what, if anything, do you think evangelicals can really do about it? And not that it's just evangelicals alone, but a lot of other churches tend to have a unified sense of doctrine at least.
My greatest fear in this respect is even this. I know privately there are a lot of Christians who know the truth, and privately they will tell you that this is what the truth really is. But they are really afraid of facing the camera and saying it, because there's a lot of consequences that is going to follow. I have a documentary in the office, if you're interested, where somebody went and interviewed somebody in Focus on the Family. And I was amazed, because I listened to Focus on the Family, but most of the time their argument is kind of more or less like middle class values, I would argue. But in this program, a documentary, which they know that is not going to be accessed by many people in this country, the guy made it very clear. He said, the desire of the market is always to expand. They know that. The Bible says that children are a gift from God. Do you think that corporate Americans think they sit down in their boardroom and say, oh, children are a gift of God in America, so let's sit down around this table and make a decision about how we can bless these children because they are a gift from God? No! They are just a market. They don't care whether your child grows really very well. It's about they want him or her to go and spend that money, consumer confidence. Okay? So I thought the analysis by this guy on Focus on the Family was right. The market actually competes with evangelicals in the sense that evangelical Christianity is committed to this Christianity that believes the transformation of the mind, the body, and soul. The market is not just interested in you using your cash. It is interested in getting, penetrating right into your soul and into your consciousness and mind. And for you to function in a capitalist society effectively, you need to have a particular kind of consciousness, a particular kind of attitude. And if you list those attitudes and you compare it with the attitude of what it means to be a good Christian, you find out that they don't necessarily square. You know, they don't square up. So what you're saying is really, so I'm more concerned about the fact that there are a lot of Christians who know the truth, but they will never stand up and say it because they are afraid of the consequences. If any major pastor stand up and tell the truth behind the camera, they will start. They can make your life difficult for you, very, very difficult for you. So if when you talk about prophetic role, if we have prophets, but they will never stand up and speak the truth, then what is prophethood there? You know, they just talk about it just in their bedroom with their wives? No. Okay, let's...
With that exhortation, I'm sure the conversation can continue. But yeah. I do want to, as a group, thank you and encourage you to hang around and talk.
Okay, thank you very much.